Yeah, 8 days. Like the Beatles. Uh-huh. March 2nd, 1940. You want to do what your armies did decades ago, an enormous attack against the same enemies as before, but you don't want the same result. So what do? You come up with something totally different. I'm Indy Neidell. This is World War II. Last week, the Soviet offensive against the Finns continued. The Finns have by now mostly retreated to their intermediate line of defense. Sweden refused to send military aid to the Finns, and in Germany, Adolf Hitler was making plans for invasions in the north and the west. And revised orders for that attack in the west are issued this week, the 24th, after Hitler's meeting last week with General Erich von Manstein. Now the role of Army Group A and an attack through the Ardennes are emphasized. Generals Gerd von Rundstedt and Fedor von Bock, the main commanders, have been thinking in terms of infantry-based ideas, though Hitler and Manstein are very much not. OKH demonstrated its institutional strengths. It worked merely as a handmaiden of a strong master. Now that it had a clear expression of its master's voice, it concentrated all its efforts of transforming the elements of the Manstein-Hitler conception into a detailed and watertight operation order. This is a strong, armored attack through the Ardennes into the rear of the British and French north of the Somme. The proposal issued now, just 1 week after Hitler and Manstein's talk, is codenamed Sickelschnitt, sickle stroke, and is basically a reversal of the Schlieffen plan the Germans used in World War I. The expectation then was that if there were a war, the French would push across into Germany and thus could be outflanked through Belgium. Now they figure the French and British will push into Belgium so they can be outflanked through the Ardennes. It's a double bluff, right? And it does have an added bonus. Let's say the French and British do not push into Belgium. An Ardennes push will still be so unexpected, especially with the power and speed of armored units, that there is every chance they'd still hit the Allies in the rear anyhow. The missions of Army Groups A, B, and C are as follows. B, in the north, under von Bock, will break into Belgium and the Netherlands. The idea is to draw the French and British as far to the east as possible so they can be outflanked. That's what Group A, under von Rundstedt in the center, will hopefully be doing, after advancing through the Ardennes, taking control of Meuse River crossings, then heading northwest along the River Somme toward Amiens and the Channel. Wilhelm Ritter von Lieb's Group C in the south will engage the defenses of the Maginot Line. He'll have no armored divisions, though, and Bock will have three. Rundstedt will use seven to spearhead his advance. Bock is not at all happy about this plan and complains vehemently to Franz Halder, chief of OKH staff. You will be creeping by 10 miles from the Maginot Line with the flank of your breakthrough and hope that the French will watch inertly. You are cramming the massive tank units together into the sparse roads of the Ardennes mountain country as if there were no such thing as air power. And you then hope to be able to lead an operation as far as the coast with an open southern flank 200 miles long where stands the mass of the French army. Bock is very much thinking of the last German open flank advance, that towards Paris in 1914. That was stopped at the Battle of the Marne and then descended into trench warfare. And, you know, he's kind of right that if the plan fails, that's what will happen again. But this plan cannot fail the same way as the Schlieffen plan did in 1914. As Keegan points out, the Maginot Line is not a unified place like Fortress Paris from which counterattacks can just spring forth. Its structure pretty much confines the French to defense against frontal attacks. And no one is going to be creeping by the Maginot Line anyhow. The tank divisions will be going 50 or 60 kilometers per day. That's what they did in Poland. And the French army, no matter where positioned, does not have that capability. And in the air, the Luftwaffe has better ground-to-air coordination and better planes, more planes, than the British and French air forces combined. I know I'm referring to Keegan a lot today, but he does an excellent job of explaining the situation, particularly the German planes. They have the Messerschmitt 109 fighters, very fast, very maneuverable, quick climbing, and well-armed. They have the Junkers 87s for dive bombing, deadly when the defense's AA guns are just visually aimed. They have the Heinkel 111s for medium bombing, and what they do not have are the obsolete types of aircraft that make up big chunks of the French and British air power. Panzer divisions know that their coordination with the Luftwaffe means that when they call for air support, it comes right on time and right where they want it. Now, the actual tanks themselves are not superior to those of the British or the French, but they are organized into entire tank divisions with no unmechanized infantry or artillery, so they are fast, maneuverable, and independent. The British have only one armored division, and it's still being formed. The French have hundreds more tanks than the Germans in total, it's true, but half of them are distributed among infantry divisions, which are slow, and half of the rest to hybrid cavalry or mech divisions. So the French have only five armored divisions, three of which are active. Well, again, sickle stroke is issued this week, and the planning will grow ever more detailed. As are various plans from all over for interfering with either Norway, Finland, or both. The Finnish minister to London tells Lord Halifax March the 1st that Force Stratford, the planned British force that will land in Norway and then help the Finns against the Soviets, will arrive far too late to provide any help. Also that day, British High Command warns that the force maybe can't work as a military operation in any case. If the Swedes put up any opposition at all to being a conduit, which command thinks likely, then the French and British won't reach the battle zone in time to be of any use, and might not even reach the iron fields at Gällivare in the north of Sweden, which are a vital supply for the Germans, before the Germans get there. Also March 1st, Hitler advises his generals in planning Weserübung, the invasion of Norway and Denmark, with a directive that explains that they will anticipate English action against Scandinavia and the Baltic. They would secure our supplies of iron ore from Sweden and would provide the Navy and Air Force with expanded bases for operations against England. This operation is to have the character of a peaceful occupation, though any resistance will be crushed by any means necessary. Hitler closes by saying that the campaign will be the most daring and most important undertaking in the history of warfare. Okay, so that's Norway. What about Finland? Franco-British foreign policy towards Finland is to be characterized by muddle and incompetence. On the 29th, Moscow receives word that the Finns accept peace terms in principle and are prepared to immediately negotiate. But that night, French Prime Minister Edouard Daladier telegrams Helsinki promising 50,000 French troops by the end of March if the Finns continue to resist. The Finns believe it enough to stall peace negotiations through the end of the week. In the field, as this week gets underway, the intermediate line begins bending under the strain of the Red Army. Within a day or two at Honkaniemi Station, for example, the Finns are down to just 40 or so defenders. But there, on the 26th, comes something rather unique. The only Finnish armored attack of the entire Winter War. Yep. For this, the Finns use a company of 13 Vickers tanks they bought just before the war and outfitted with 37mm guns. The Soviets are astonished. They have never seen a Finnish tank, and the Finns have some initial success until they run into Soviet tanks, whose armor deflects the Finnish tank fire, but whose own fire proves devastating. William Trotter has this to say about the attack. The whole operation has a ring of desperation to it. A great deal more service could have been gotten from those tanks instead of wasting them in a charge. Soviet commander Semyon Timoshenko plans a huge offensive against the intermediate line for the 28th. But whom would his men attack? By then, Finnish commander Carl Gustav Mannerheim has given his go-ahead for a retreat to the third line of defense, the rear line, and the assault is against positions that were mostly empty, though the Finns did man enough delaying positions to once again give them precious time. And here are two notes to end the week. On the 25th, the largest British leaflet-dropping campaign of the war begins. It will last 6 days and will involve leaflets in the millions. And at the end of February, Dr. Fritz Todt is chosen to centralize the direction of all the new labor Germany has for military production. I will talk more about that next week. For now, this 8-day week comes to an end. 8 days because of the leap year in 1940, but not 2019. Finland is still holding on, and a French promise has removed the Finns from the negotiating table. Everyone is still planning to invade Norway, but the Germans are making big plans for the West. Which is something genuinely new. An attack through the Ardennes? Multiple armored divisions? Avoiding trench warfare entirely? Yep, that would be new if it comes to fruition. But as we've seen in both this war and the Great War, doing something spectacularly new leads to either spectacular success or spectacular failure. Speaking of something new, last month we started working for the famous heavy metal band Sabaton on the Sabaton History Channel, where we cover the real historical background to their songs. If you have not yet checked it out, you can start right here. Our TimeGhost Army Member of the Week is Carl Engel. His monetary contribution helps make sure we can continue bringing you this series. Join him and join us in the TimeGhost Army at Patreon or at timeghost.tv. See you next time.